All right, Sanderson, we're good to go.
Hello, hello, and welcome to Sunday Assembly. It is wonderful to have people here. People are joining the whole time, which is good. Kind of small, sound of a small child next to me, not torturing an animal. Please do say where you are calling in from. That would be great. Just go into the chat and just let us know. Oh, we've got Sharon calling in. That's wonderful. Abby from Newcastle. Super. Got Tottenham in the house. Well done. There's someone has made sure that all our social media links in there. That's the most important thing. Guys, basically, if you're not following us online, then what are you even doing? And please do make yourselves at home wherever you are. Get comfortable. Go and get ready because we've got an amazing Sunday assembly around there. Thank you very much, Sarah, for saying that you've got a noiseful child. That is a nicer way of putting it, you know, nicer than noisy, I think. Good to see we've got London in the house there. Oh, we've got the whole Sandal family calling in from Westminster. And today is it's a Sunday assembly, which is really important to us because it was sort of chosen for Black History Month, but, you know, obviously wanting to get deeper and, you know, anyone who's been part of Sunday Assembly knows that this is a community which is really sort of driven by social justice, by wanting to make the world as it should be and not just living the world as it is. Someone's gone and chimed in. I quite like the sort of discussion of the topic and also doing the hellos. Someone's put a little I Burman see you joke there. If you can enter your names and where you're from and include a pun, you know, that is, that's great too. Charlotte went and did it unprovoked, unasked for. It's Carloy. That, but no, you lost me there. Okay, now I'm sort of just trying to figure out what's going on, but I feel that I'm witnessing some private jokes, which I can't get, which is a sort of confusing experience. Maybe I thought Charlotte was having some sort of private joke, but I think she just misspelled her name. So there we go. I'm back in it. I am Sanderson. I am going to be your host for the rest of the Sunday Assembly. For people who have not been to a Sunday Assembly before, welcome to our digital Sunday Assembly. Normally, we meet in a hall. Normally, we are able to be with each other. We're able to speak. We're able to sing together. We're able to do all of these amazing things, which we are going to do with bells on when that vaccine comes. And frankly, if the vaccine comes, and we're going to do it in Zorbs, we're going to get hazmat suits and do it together in the future. Whatever happens, there will be a time when we are going to meet in person again. And I'm sure that you are excited as I am about that. But one of the amazing things about this is that, we do get to have friends who are calling in from Canada, and from Newcastle as well. So at this time when we can feel very separate, in fact, there's, you know, this wonderful little place of connection. And I always think that connection, it's, you know, it doesn't only come from being in the same room as someone. How often have you been in an office? How often have you maybe sort of been living with people, sometimes even in a relationship, and you are sharing physical space, but you're not emotionally connected? And that's a great thing about Sunday Assembly. And in this gathering, it is a gathering about connection. And, you know, when you connect around values, then you do feel that You know, you do feel that you have got this connection to people, that you are united around trying to make something happen. So, we have got Nadena, our guest speaker, is letting us know that she's calling in from Sheffield. And so I think that is, without further ado, let's get going. We have a first song, and if you have been to Sunday Assembly before, then you will be well versed in just singing along. If this is your first time, then you are, just give it a go. You're going to be on mute, so don't worry, no one will hear you. But just so that you know what's going to be happening, there's going to be a couple of songs. Then we've got an amazing poet. Then we have our main speaker, the aforementioned Nadena from Sheffield. Then we've got a moment of reflection. Someone from the community goes and tells a story. And then we have the notices and the sing-along. And we end with breakout rooms, where we've got a chance to go and meet and connect to each other. So, guys, are we all ready to get started? Are we ready to sing a song? Are we ready to sing a song? Just give yourselves a round of applause there. Give yourselves a round of applause and welcome to Sunday Assembly. This is a, we are a secular congregation that celebrates life. We've got a really simple set of values to deliver. my gosh. What a wonderful way to kickstart things. Guys, there's a quite really important question to ask. What's better than one song? Two songs. So let's have a second song. Oh my gosh, I'm using headphones this time, so I can't really hear myself sing. It's so much more fun. Oh my gosh, I'm just absolutely loving today.
Games, changes and fears. When will they come from you? When will they stop? I believe that faith has brought us here. See my ride.
I was asking you to give yourselves a round of applause, everyone, for singing and for joining in and for all the people who made that amazing video. It was fantastic. That's the first time that I've listened to that song and thought about it, about physical proximity. It's like, oh no, that suddenly brought a whole sort of, my world crumbles when you are not near. I mean, never before had I thought that sort of being able to actually be sort of physically close to someone would be so vital. So welcome everyone to this Sunday Assembly. The theme is the Miseducation of Britain, and that is what we're going to explore today. I am a huge history buff, and so I mean, and it's one of these things that even I, when I go and reflect on the history that I learned at university, the history that I learned at school, that how few black faces there were in it, and how little the sort of history of Africa, the history of, black peoples sort of out of Africa as well, are covered. And that was really brought home to me recently when I started listening to a podcast about the Haitian Revolution. And I don't know, maybe you're one of those people who has, knows the Haitian revolution inside and out, but I was not one of those people. And that is a sort of black slave uprising. And it's not only a black slave uprising, but it was before where there was in Haiti in the 18th and 19th century, in Haiti in the 18th and 19th century, there was not only sort of a lot of slaves, but there was also a whole black middle class in this colony. And that's just a part of history that I didn't know about at all. And this was a revolution which was entirely powered by black people. And it's a revolution which I know nothing about. And so I'm so delighted that we've got this theme, which is about, not just about knowing these figures, but really integrating them into our knowledge and the ways of seeing the world. So I'm super delighted that you've all turned up to go and dig into this topic. And so now we're going to go and have our first guest contributor. And that is a wonderful poet who I am very delighted and very pleased to, hear and pleased to welcome to you. Please welcome Samira Albarja.
Hi, everyone. Honestly, the first part was amazing. I was so into it. Wonderful. But yeah, today I'm going to be performing a piece I actually wrote in the midst of when there was a lot of protests going on and Black Lives Matter really took to the media and took to all of these stages. So that's what it kind of motivated me to make this poem. It's called I Can't Breathe, and I hope you guys enjoy. I can't breathe. What does that mean to you? Not for a person of color, but for a human. It screams, stop. It shouts that the air is being robbed from my lungs, that my heart will soon no longer continue to beat because I have been robbed. But you see, these thieves took more than my life. They took my dignity and they took my freedom in a world that oddly preaches freedom when we are actually plastered with an unjust system and parents are supposed to raise their children under the law and legislation of the unrighteous. I'm sorry, I can't take that. I can't breathe. Do we really live in a world where the new virus is racism? Where our skin color suddenly defines our credibility and you better make sure to do a double check on the black man over there because they're all criminals, right? Just because the news sprinkles particles of statistics on an open wound just to injure, not to heal, just to encourage the breeding ground of hatred again and an endless cycle of death to keep carrying on, I can't breathe. And our excuse is, well, what can I say? We live in an unjust world. But unfortunately, our color does define who we are and how we are predicted to act and how a black individual acts is already scripted. So either way, you lose. But the problem stems far beyond the thousands of innocent black people killed just by accident. I can't breathe. It stems from the systematic racism carved into the DNA of the police force. George Floyd, 46 years old with two children. He was a parent too. But did they care? No. They kept looking through the lens of color while suffocating him until he had his last dying breath. I can't breathe. What was it, officer? What was so threatening about a man who was known as a friendly giant, a man who allegedly committed forgery, yet you pinned him down mercilessly like he committed first degree murder or rape? He was a simple man. And I may be in the UK, but I can still feel his pain like I was there in the US, Minneapolis. I can't breathe. Counterfeit money was his crime. And I'm not scraping away the severity, I'm giving the correct dosage because this injustice shouldn't be carrying on. Dylan Roof is a man who's still alive, breathing well, after he committed an unforgivable monstrosity of a sin, killing 9 Black African-American citizens, a considered hate crime. He was peacefully arrested. He wasn't screaming for his life because his skin color whispered in the ears of the officers, "My skin isn't dangerous." So they believed his plea, and they believed his people. The stereotypical connotation of white skin is clean. It eludes us to believe their innocence. It's the brightness, the freshness. In school, we're always taught that black connotes darkness as something dirty. The connection of these words has no relevance to the skin color painted with melanin beauty. This is because our fairy tale description of today's good and bad guys is distorted. The good guys have black capes with skin color white as parchment, and the bad guys are behind bars of 6 feet deep with the purest hearts. I can't breathe. The unjust system is plain as day, and I don't need to be a judge in a court for that jurisdiction. Remove that lens, tailored personally for you by the media and the prison statistics, so we can all breathe, because we all bleed the same and we feel for each other's pain. So we can all breathe, please. Let us live. Thank you.
Wow, guys, give a big round of applause to Samira there. Thank you so, so much. That was beautiful. I had unmuted. I don't know when I stopped or when I started there. Or maybe what happened is I unmuted at the same time you unmuted me, and we got into some weird sort of unmuting lock-off there. But Samira, thanks so much. It was amazing. I only wish that we were in a hall together so that when everyone applauded, you'd have been able to really feel how much you would have touched everyone's hearts and how grateful they were to you for what you did. So thank you so much. That was really beautiful. And we're going to go from a sort of artistic exploration of racism and how it affects people to, a sort of more academic view, but this will not be academic in that sense of it being dry or distant, but sort of very well researched and super grounded in all of the sort of relevant research around this. So please put your hands together and welcome, even if you're just on your own, just still do a round of applause, because yeah, I think Nadena will still feel it over Zoom. Nadena Doherty!
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me? Okay, yes. Fantastic. Yes. Thank you so much to Stephanie and everyone as part of the assembly for the invitation. Samira, that was so beautiful, so powerful. Really has touched me. So I really appreciate the generous invitation to talk at this assembly. It's important that we have some form of connectedness in a world where we are so disconnected, having different lockdowns in different regions. So I think this is so enriching. So thank you again. I'm just going to speak very briefly about the kind of subtle racisms known as racial microaggressions. And I think Samira highlighted it really well, the kind of implicit ideas that people have about skin tone and what that means, black skin, white skin, so on. But my research kind of looks at how black history is or isn't taught in school curricula in England. I should be clear about that. And the kind of deficit ways in which black history manifests when it does appear. So currently, black history isn't mandated in the curriculum. And that means it sort of says you can look at black history, but it doesn't specifically say you must as part of the enslaved people. And it's important to use the term enslaved rather than slaves, because slaves is kind of like a job, like a plumber or an electrician, a slave, but enslaved denotes that it wasn't a choice. And so enslaved people can appear through Black History in Black History Month, which is every October in England. So Black students and students going to school can often turn up on the 1st of October, and they will either learn about token heroes, so kind of Martin Luther King, the civil rights, you know, those sorts of people of particular note, or they will learn about enslaved people. And a lot of my research has shown it's kind of really, really repetitive. And I was asking questions about why that was. And now when we think about racism, we think of traditionally in our kind of popular understanding of it, we think of the kind of egregious, in your face, really obvious forms of racism, like the tragic death of George Floyd. But obviously there are loads of other examples as well. But what we think less about are the small, everyday instances of racism that we kind of normalize and accept in our society. And those are called racial microaggressions. The micro doesn't denote that it's small and insignificant. It just means that it's kind of everyday, it's around, it happens. And, you know, for people of color to continue living in this society, sometimes we just have to let it go over. Our head. So I'll give you an example. I could out to start a lecture, and then I will have one of my colleagues at the university who put his head around and say, you know, has the lecturer arrived yet? And to you, you might think, oh, you know, maybe that's just a harmless mistake. Okay, maybe it's a harmless mistake, but, you know, do I look like the kind of person that would be a lecturer? I can then go to my office, and this actually has happened. All of these examples have happened. I can go to my office, and then a colleague will mistake me for the other Black colleague who looks nothing like me. Okay, so then I can go to my emails, open my emails, and I will have a flurry of requests to speak about diversity only. Okay, so that's the only kind of box that I'm in. So those are the kinds of everyday sort of subtle examples where, you know, my colleague who mistook me for someone else isn't thinking to themselves, how can I be as racist as possible? They're not thinking like that. It is just an unconscious slip of the tongue. But what does it mean when this kind of thing happens all of the time? And so racial microaggressions, there are different types of them. And just very briefly, I will go through the kind of three main types. Okay, so the first one is micro invalidation, and it's kind of communications. So it's unconscious, but there are communications that negate or nullify the thoughts and realities of a person of color. So it might be, for example, in a meeting, you could have somebody that, you know, it's the sighing, the rolling of the eyes, the here we go again, the silence that fills the space. They are communications that it tell a person of color that what they have to say, you know, isn't of significance. Then you have another one, micro insults. And these are sort of communications, again, that can convey rudeness and insensitivity that demean a person's racial heritage or identity. Okay, so again, it's it can be the sighing, it can be the exclusions from meetings, it can be the insulting way somebody might talk about, I don't know, for example, I've been asked, you know, where are you from? And I'll say, oh, I was born in Bristol. And they'll say, no, where are you really from? Because they're not getting at, you know, are sort of asking you, where is your Black skin from? Because you don't look like you quite belong here. And then the last one is micro assaults. Now, that's the kind of really obvious verbal hurt the intended victim. So it might be name calling, avoidant behavior, purposeful discriminatory actions. Okay, so there are different types and they are manifest in different ways. And the person who came up with racial microaggressions, his name is Dr. Chester Pierce. He's not alive anymore, but he was a psychiatrist in America. He applied this kind of definition to African-Americans specifically. And he said that people of colour, African Americans, end up having to create a range of survival techniques to kind of dilute, to postpone, or to deflect that stress of having that everyday kind of racism happening towards them. So the reason why I'm telling you about racial microaggressions is because if you have a curriculum, a history curriculum, which says that you can teach Black history, but you don't have to, I want you to think if it's conceivable that majority white teachers who will have grown up on a monocultural diet themselves will know to go and find the resources needed to teach more diverse narratives. A lot of the research shows that teachers don't feel comfortable opening that can of worms, so to speak, because they don't know about it themselves, they've never learned about it, but also the resources aren't there. So what you end up with is Black history being taught from what white teachers think of for Black history. And you don't know what research will be different types of racial microaggressions for Black history. An example is, I don't want to over talk. So how much time have I got left? Can you give me like a sign of how many minutes I've got left?
Let me see, 11:30. Oh, hi. Oh, you can hear me. Sorry. You have 8 minutes left. I didn't realize my sound was on.
How long, sorry?
You have 8 minutes left.
8 minutes, okay, thank you. So what you can end up with is slave performances. So in a particular school in the North, I sat through students who are 13 and 14 being taken to a hall, and they were asked to take different roles. So somebody had to be a slave, an overseer, and they had to kind of trade and imagine life on a plantation, and they had to act it out. They had props like rulers for whips, and it was all kind of, yeah, really sherry. It was really, really painful watching. And so often when I tell people, and the teacher rationalized this, he said, you know, we want to develop empathy. We want them to put themselves into the shoes of somebody else and to see why that is wrong. But my return would be, would you do the same for teaching the Holocaust? So would you have mini gas chambers? Would you have people as Jews? Would you do that? And of course, they would never do that. And they were horrified even at the question, because they realized there are some histories that, oh, in fact, probably all histories that you don't need to act out in order to understand how terrible it was. And so for the students in that class, Black, white, brown students, however they self-identified, they realized that there was a hierarchy in learning about different histories, that Black history could be reduced to a performance. You could have a laugh. Remember that they're 13 and 14 with rulers in a hall. It felt like fun. And so that could be reduced to something that was silly and not taken seriously. And then you could have every single year, I'm not saying that you shouldn't learn about it, but every single year you had the First and Second World Wars, which were kind of whites only when you were learning about it in the school. And that was sensitively applied and sensitively taught and sensitively approached. And you would also go to museums and learn about it in a kind of respectful way. So that's a kind of tangible example of how Black history and Beth, thank you. I can see that you've written about Asia being homogenized. Black history was also synonymous with history from Southeast Asia as well. So you would have a conflation of civil rights, and then you'd move quickly to abolition because, you know, we need Britain's leading role in abolition rather than Britain's complicity in the slave trade. And then you would move on to kind of to particular elements of South Asian history as well. And so that's kind of what I want to speak to you today about. You know, we've had Black Lives Matter. and a kind of global recognition that the real epidemic is racism. I saw those placards and that was really helpful to know. But we seem to be sliding backwards with comments from the Equalities Minister about white privilege being white victimhood is designed to then re-center white privilege as it already is in the curriculum. So we don't ever close the book on the 31st of October and say, right, we're now moving back to white history from the 1st of November. What we do is we say history is just history, but we need to be very critical about what we mean by just history, who is being centered. And white privilege is a recognition that there is no impediment. It's not to say that you don't have challenges in your life, that you don't live kind of paycheck to paycheck, or you don't have different issues that affect your life. It's just an awareness that you are not impeded because of your skin color. And so white privilege is not about white shaming and white victimhood, but we need to make sure that we're still having those conversations, that we don't let the gains of Black Lives Matter and having that in our kind of national dialogue be lost amongst the noise of, you know, we need to stop shaming white people because it is. And as Samira helpfully and very powerfully explained, you know, racism really does cost lives. And even the small racial microaggressions really do impact on Black and brown communities. And that's, I'll stop there. So thank you.
What a powerful talk. Thank you so much, Nadena, for that. That's really important and really useful stuff. I'm trying not to do the thing where you then center a talk on something you did wrong as a white person. But as you sort of mentioned, the fact that Black history does then go and get reduced to this history of slavery, I was like, oh my gosh, when I brought up the Haitian slave rebellion that happened to just be a podcast I was listening to, and in fact there were so many complexities to it and really admirable political characters, but now I've just done the same thing. So anywho, I want to thank you for all that you've done. Hopefully my own reactions to it, something for me to think about as well, but I just know that I've learned so much from that, and I really hope that not only us as individuals but also as the Sunday Assembly community, that we can now be more aware of, you know, how we are sort of which histories we're centering, which stories we're telling, which narratives we are bringing to the forefront. And with Samira's poem and Nadena's amazing talk, we now have a moment of reflection. And so this is an opportunity just for you to just shut your eyes if you want to maybe just take a moment away from all of these talks and lockdowns or anything else, or maybe just for quiet, or maybe take some time to reflect on the talks that you've heard and the ideas that have been brought up. But it is a moment of reflection. Thank you, everyone, for joining in. Oh, I'm gonna. The great thing about the mute button is I just did an enormous sneeze there, and I was able to totally mute it. So it was like a victimless crime. So what we're going to do now is that at the end of every single Sunday assembly, there we have these breakout groups, and they're a place where we can actually go and talk to each other. You know, one of the wonders of Sunday assembly is that connection between the community. So now there's going to be one group, which is the group number one, which is going to be for people for whom this is their first time. So if you want to go at the end of the assembly and be put into that group, if you just rename yourself on Zoom, you can do that by just going rename. And if you put a one in front of your name, then as I'm doing now, then you're going to be put in group number one and you'll be meeting other people who are first timers. But then what you might want to do is Nadena has very kindly offered to do a Q&A on her talk in one group. So if you just put two in front of your name, then you'll be put in Nadena's group for a short Q&A. So that's something that if you do that now, and then we can start doing some stuff, setting that up in the background whilst it's happening. So, we are now moving on to this much I know, and that is when someone from the community goes and talks about how they are engaging with this topic or how they're trying to live their best life. And today we have Chiron Edwards. So put your digital hands together for Chiron!
Hello, my name is Chiron Edwards. I had a trailer that I was going to play before the talk so it makes more sense. So I'm going to screen. What about?
What is the digital version of Stop and Search? You know, you don't need to look very far. The Matrix, the Gang's Matrix. What you had is a tool that was created by the Metropolitan Police to satisfy questions from Boris Johnson after the London riots. There was a political context where you had a quote that was given to me from someone senior at the Met. We had Boris asking, how many gang members have you got in London? And so we had to answer him. And so the Gangs Matrix was born. This is a database, 90% black and ethnic minority, who's being slapped with the label gang nominal.
I've had young people who have been arrested with other young men, and they've been held longer than their counterparts, than their white peers.
More than 3/4 of the database is black, and only 1/4 of people involved in serious violence in London are black. How can you explain such a huge disparity?
Once we start putting people into boxes, we face a dangerous risk, because oppression against one is oppression against all. And that's the reality of it, and I don't think people understand that.
Trying to figure out how to use this thing. So in 2019, a friend, Andre, approached me to make a documentary with him about the Gangs Matrix. The Gangs Matrix is a secret police database containing personal information that police personal details of those police consider to be in a gang. After Andre approached me, he later emailed me a couple of news articles and a 27-page document about the subject. And we made the documentary last year, which was self-funded by us interviewing people from human rights to organizations and charities like Amnesty International, Stopwatch and the Forefront Project. This documentary was made way before the death of George Floyd and the merging and the merging of the Black Lives Matter movement across the world. But his death subsequent and the subsequent events that have made this important and to highlight the gang's matrix, and I still feel is irrelevant today. How much do I have left of?
About 3 minutes, if that's okay.
Okay. Yeah, that's pretty much kind of what I have so far. I don't really have much to talk about.
That's fine. We can move on to the next one.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much, Kyron.
Thank you so much, Kyron, for that talk and highlighting this thing, which is right in our midst, that, Sunday Assembly London, we live in a city where there are groups of young black and brown people who are sort of being, systematically having their opportunities removed and then also systematically categorized and targeted in terms of sort of police searches. And my wife recently started a job at a charity which does youth work in an estate in Camberwell, does it? And yeah, just hearing about the sort of lived realities of the people on that estate. She was recently speaking to a young black girl who said that, I believe, 13 of her friends had been killed. Friends or connections, and that this was something which she just lived with and became a part of her life. And yeah, there we are. We live in this city, and yet there are people who are sort of experiencing a life which, essentially living with that amount of death, is as though you are living in a war zone. And how are we sort of doing the work which can go and help change that, when actually so many of the sort of trends in our society seems to be blaming the people for whom this is happening to, as opposed to genuinely supporting them. There was, speaking to some people in her charity, she said actually a spate of the this youth charity she worked with, they had a youth centre on an estate, and in this youth centre it was the only place where a lot of people who could have been sort of seen as being confrontational, they would all be able to get together here. And actually, when that building got shut down, like a lot of people in that estate go and link that building being shut down and the youth clubs being shut down to suddenly people not congregating as friends in a sort of controlled area, and sort of leading to a lot of this violence. And so, these issues of race, they are, permeating everything that we do. So thank you, Kyron. Thank you so much there. Guys, please give Kyron a round of applause. And thanks so much for sharing. Where can we find that documentary?
The documentary is on my Vimeo page and is on YouTube. I think we're doing a Q&A. I can't remember the name. We're doing like a Q&A soon, over Zoom. We're gonna try and organize some more like online screenings and Q&As in the future.
Great. Well, look, we're going to make sure that we go and get that out and make it available. If anyone can find it and put it in the chat, that would be great as well. So then people can find it very easily. Yeah. At Sunday Assembly, we assemble on a Sunday to hear amazing speakers like Samira, Nadena and Kyron. But there's also so many other activities and sort of running many of them is a sort of like an evil presence, the sort of puppet master of Sunday Assembly, a malicious force who is temporarily using his powers for good. Please put your hands together and welcome Andrew Wood.
Thank you, Samson. That's very kind. As you should know by now, yes, Sunday Assembly doesn't just shut down at 12:30 on the first and third Sunday of every month. We've got a whole host of activities designed to help you get through the November lockdown. And as you just heard, it kicks off straight after this assembly. So we have now in the chat a link to the Zoom meeting for the Gangs Matrix. So if Kyron's trying my best, has whetted your appetite, then join the hosting of his 20-minute documentary. He'll be doing a Q&A session at 2 o'clock today. But this is a different Zoom link. It's not the same as this one. So you can see it about three messages up in the chat function now. So register beforehand and you can join that at 2 o'clock today. Now, that was today. On to tomorrow, and every Monday from 7:20, Sunday Assembly Choir meets. You've seen the amazing stuff they produce in the form of our songs. And if you want to be part of that, then we're posting a link. We have already posted a link, amazing, to the virtual event on Facebook now. And as it's November, they've begun to work on Christmas songs. Christmas songs, wonder what that could be rehearsing for. Maybe we'll find out later. But onto this Tuesday, 3rd of November. Don't worry, I'm not gonna do events for every single day this month. But this Tuesday at 7:30 is the Sunday Assembly Article Club. And they will be discussing two articles. The first one is about a tiny town in southern Greenland that's fighting for its future because it sits by one of the world's largest deposits of uranium. And the second article is a debate about why English is so different from other languages. But is it? Well, that's for you to decide, but only if you register on the meetup link, which is appearing on a chat function near you. Yes, there it is. Now, if that's not enough language debate for you, just a week today, the next Sunday Assembly East End Book Club meeting will be happening. So that's next Sunday, the 8th of November, and they'll be discussing the Etymologicon, which you might be able to work out from the name, is a book about the hidden collections of the English language. So this really is a month for the linguophiles at Sunday Assembly. Again, link there in the chat function. Now, on Tuesday the 24th of November at 7 p.m, we have the next monthly meeting of the Sunday Assembly Lively Poet Society, a link to their Facebook group, again, on the chat function. Brilliantly done, Mitski. And that is almost everything. So our next assembly, 2 weeks away, 15th of November, the main speaker will be L.J. Flanders, a former inmate of Pentonville Prison who turned his life around when he developed his cell workout and self-published a book about it. Wow, so the Joe Wicks of Pentonville, so don't miss that. And then we have our usual two assemblies in December, plus two sneak previews for you. We'll have an online quiz on Tuesday the 8th of December, hosted, of course, by Quizmaster Matt Lockwood. And then Yule Rock is back. More specifically, it's our first ever Sunday Assembly global Christmas event. It's not called Yule Rock. It's the Yule Lockdown Rockdown. See what they've done there? On the evening of Saturday, the 19th of December, featuring assemblies from the UK and around the world. So bookmark that date, Saturday, 19th of December. I mean, to be honest, what else are you likely to be doing? So, we look forward to that. And they were your notices. Over to Ange.
Hello, everyone. Hi, thanks, Andy. And yeah, lots of things going on in the coming month to help us connect. And I would like to, first of all, say thank you to everybody. So this is the bit where we do talk a little bit about money and how you all can support Sunday Assembly. But you're all supporting Sunday Assembly by turning up here, whether this assembly, going to a group or volunteering for the last few months, and for the people who have been donating and helping to support us do what we do. And that is very much about building connection in lots of different ways. So thank you. A massive hug to all of you. So at the moment, we are in a fairly good financial position because of the situation with the pandemic, which is like a funny place for us to be and feel. But that's because our costs have been a lot lower this year. And we are looking to have a tiny surplus at the end of the year. And you might go, does that mean we don't need any money? Well, we are looking forward into next year, and we know that the costs of going back to Conway Hall will be as high as they were before. So we are, if not more. So we're looking at that cost of about £1,000 per assembly once we go back. So like any sensible kind of savers, what we're trying to do is to build up a pot of money to support being able to go back to face-to-face at a time where it will be distanced probably to start off with, but also that we know that there will be people who want to join via streaming, and that's something we really want to continue doing. So there will also be some costs to that. So anything, if you're able to financially give at the moment, you can, will help us to be able to do that, continuing building that connection with the community and making a smoother transition when we go back to meeting physically and keeping everybody on board. So you can do that in various ways. There are lots of ways to support, even if you don't have money to give yourself. So one way is to go to sundayassembly.com/donate, or and that will take you to our donation page, which will show you lots of different ways you can give. You can give online, via Enthuse. There's a link to it on there, either regularly or as a one-off. And it also will tell you about other things that you can do, like giving while you shop online. And let's face it, we're going to be doing our Christmas shopping online mostly. So you can shop online and we can get a donation for Sunday Assembly from those stores with no cost to you. So lots of different ways to get involved there. And also, there is a way that if you want to donate right now on the day, you can use our text giving facility. So you get your phone and you text SANOV, make a space, then 5270085. That will let you donate £5. If you want to donate more or less, you just change that number 5 into the amount that you want to give. If you don't want to get any further information or comms on that, then after that, then there's another link there you can do. And all of those links are going in the chat. But as I say, lots of different ways of giving and supporting the community. And I just thank you for everybody turning up and doing stuff, because you're all fab. And it has made my life much, much easier in recent months to know that I'm going to see some friendly faces and do stuff. And we're going to keep doing that as we go on through the next few months. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much for that. I'm unmuted, so we can I can carry on. Ange, that was very well done. I also want to thank everyone who donates to keep this afloat. It will be great to be able to come back to Conway Hall, but there is that weird thing where it's like returning is also you know, we've got to realise that what we're signing up for, we love it so much, let's make sure that we can afford it when we go back there. So thanks so much to you. Thanks so much to all of the speakers today. I know that I have learned a lot from this, and it's going to really go make me reflect on the reading that I do. It's going to make me reflect on the sort of histories that I connect with. And I'm just so glad that I'm able to go and do it with this community. Bye bye. There we go. The small little man, like, he is definitely my son. He couldn't resist it, could he? He had to go and chime in and steal my thunder, make it about him. We are now going to go and move into the last song. So everyone, this is the song where we're going to be dancing along to it. So if you want to, I'm going to invite you to go and stand up so that when the spotlight gets turned to you, you can go and show your great moves, or you can just do some chair dancing. So everyone, get on your feet for the last song, Sir Duke by Stevie Wonder. And let's do this. Oh, also follow us on social media, very important. Good. Glad we saw that. Yeah.
through. You can tell right away the letter A when the people start to move. They can feel it all over. They can feel it all over, people. They can feel it all over. They can feel it all over, people. Music knows it is enough, we will be one of the things that life just won't win.
Here are some of you to
get you otherwise on stand to forget. There's Daisy Miller Satchmo with the king of all the Duke. With a voice like Ella's ringing out, there's no way the band could lose. You can feel it all over. You can feel it all over, people. You can feel it all over. You can feel it all over, people. You can feel it all over. You can feel it all over, people. You can feel it all over.
Who's been here. We're now going to be breaking up into the breakout rooms. We're going to be breaking out, not breaking up. Maybe that's a nicer way to put it.
Sanderson, will you be explaining how to do that again? I missed the explanation.
Okay, yes. So the way that you do that, depending on whether you want to be put into group one or group two, there is a, you can rename yourself. There's a little, if you put your cursor over your picture, there'll be three dots,
yeah.
And then you rename and give yourself a comical, rude name. And then, or you just put, don't do that. Do a serious name. And then one or two in front of it, but like not rude.